بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم
ياسين والقرآن الحكيم إنك لمن المرسلين على صراط مستقيم تنزيل العزيز الرحيم لتنذر قوما ما أنذر آباؤهم فهم غافلون لقد حق القول على أكثرهم فهم لا يؤمنون إنا جعلنا في أعناقهم أغلالا فهي إلى الأذقان فهم مقمحون وجعلنا من بين أيديهم سدا ومن خلفهم سدا فأغشيناهم فهم لا يبصرون وسواء عليهم أأنذرتهم أم لم تنذرهم لا يؤمنون إنما تنذر من اتبع الذكر وخشي الرحمن بالغيب فبشره بمغفرة وأجر كريم إنا نحن نحيي الموتى ونكتب ما قدموا وآثارهم وكل شيء أحصيناه في إمام مبين واضرب لهم مثلا أصحاب القرية إذ جاءها المرسلون إذ أرسلنا فكذبوهما فعززنا بثالث فقالوا إنا إليكم مرسلون قالوا ما أنتم إلا بشر مثلنا وما تطيرنا بكم لئن لم تنتهوا لنرجمنكم وليمسنكم منا عذاب أليم قالوا طائركم معكم أئن ذكرتم وجاء من أقصى المدينة رجل يسعى قال يا قوم اتبعوا المرسلين اتبعوا من لا يسألكم أجرا وهم مهتدون وما لي لا فطرني يَشْفَعُونَ أَأَتَّخِذُ مِن دُونِهِ آلِهَةً إِن يُرِدْنِ الرَّحْمَنُ بِضُرٍّ لَّا تُغْنِ عَنِّي شَفَاعَتُهُمْ لا تغن عني شفاعتهم شيئا ولا ينقذون إني إذا لفي ضلال مبين إني آمنت بربكم فاسمعون قومي يعلمون بما غفر لي ربي وجعلني من المكرمين وما أنزلنا على قومه من بعده من جند من السماء وما كنا منزلين إن كانت إلا صيحة واحدة فإذا هم خامدون يا حسرة على العباد ما يأتيهم من رسول كانوا به يستهزئون ألم يروا كم أهلكنا قبلهم من القرون أنهم إليهم لا يرجعون وإن كل لما جميع لدينا محضرون أحييناها وأخرجنا منها حبا فمنه يأكلون وجعلنا فيها جنات من نخيل وأعناب وفجرنا فيها من العيون ليأكلوا من ثمره وما عملته أيديهم أفلا يشكرون سبحان الذي خلق الأزواج كلها مما تنبت الأرض ومن أنفسهم ومما لا يعلمون وآية لهم الليل نسلخ منه النهار فإذا هم مظلمون والشمس تجري لمستقر لها ذلك تقدير العزيز العليم والقمر قدرناه منازل حتى عاد كالعرجون القديم لا الشمس ينبغي لها أن تدرك القمر ولا الليل سابق النهار وكل في فلك يسبحون وآية لهم أنا حملنا ذريتهم في الفلك المشحون وخلقنا لهم من مثله ما يركبون وإن نشأ نغرقهم فلا صريخ لهم ولا هم ينقذون إلا رحمة رحمة منا ومتاعا إلى حين. وإذا قيل لهم اتقوا ما بين أيديكم وما خلفكم لعلكم ترحمون. وما تأتيهم من آية من آيات ربهم إلا كانوا عنها معرضين. وإذا قيل لهم أنفقوا مما رزقكم الله قال الذين كفروا للذين آمنوا أنطعم من لو يشاء الله أطعمه إن أنتم إلا في ضلال مبين. ويقولون متى هذا الوعد إن كنتم صادقين. ما ينظرون إلا صيحة واحدة تأخذهم وهم يخصمون. فلا يستطيعون توصية ولا إلى أهلهم يرجعون. ونفخ في الصور فإذا هم من الأجداث إلى ربهم ينسلون. قالوا يا ويلنا من بعثنا من مرقدنا هذا ما وعد الرحمن وصدق المرسلون. إن كانت إلا صيحة واحدة فإذا هم جميع لدينا محضرون. فاليوم لا تظلم نفس شيئا ولا تجزون إلا ما كنتم تعملون. إن أصحاب الجنة اليوم في شغل فاكهون. هم وأزواجهم في ظلال على الأرائك متكئون. لهم فيها فاكهة ولهم ما يدعون. سلام قولا من رب رحيم. وامتاز اليوم أيها المجرمون. ألم أعهد إليكم يا بني آدم أن لا تعبدوا الشيطان إنه لكم عدو. ولقد أضل منكم جبلا كثيرا أفلم تكونوا تعقلون. هذه جهنم التي كنتم توعدون. اصلوها اليوم بما كنتم تكفرون. اليوم نختم على أفواههم وتكلمنا أيديهم وتشهد أرجلهم بما كانوا يكسبون. ولو قصصنا على أعينهم فاستبقوا الصراط فأنى يبصرون ولو نشاء لمسخناهم على مكانتهم فما استطاعوا مضيا ولا يرجعون ومن نعمره ننكسه في الخلق أفلا يعقلون وما علمناه الشعر وما ينبغي له إن هو إلا ذكر وقرآن مبين لينذر من كان حيا ويحق القول على الكافرين أولم يروا أنا خلقنا لهم مما عملت أيدينا ومشارب أفلا يشكرون واتخذوا من دون الله آلهة لعلهم ينصرون لا يستطيعون نصرهم وهم لهم جند محضرون فلا قولهم إنا نعلم ما يسرون وما يعلنون أولم يرى الإنسان أنا خلقناه من نطفة فإذا هو خصيم مبين وضرب لنا مثلا ونسي خلقه قال من يحيي العظام وهي رميم قل يحييها الذي أنشأها أول مرة وهو بكل خلق عليم الذي جعل لكم الشجر الأخضر نارا فإذا أنتم منه توقدون أوليس الذي خلق السماوات والأرض بقادر على أن يخلق مثلهم بلى وهو الخلاق العليم إنما أمره إذا أراد شيئا أن يقول له كن فيكون فسبحان الذي بيده ملكوت كل شيء إليه ترجعون.
Everyone, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Let's try and get to know Surah Yasin, one of the most famous, often recited surahs of the Meccan Quran. A very, very beautiful surah. I'll try to give you an overview of this surah by breaking it up into six distinct parts. That's probably one of the best ways to kind of remember what's covered in this remarkable surah. The first part of this surah actually highlights how the Quran can only be revelation and how the Quran has the power to revive hearts. That's the point of that first passage, that the Prophet has been given this recital to talk to a nation that's been completely heedless and unaware for generation upon generation upon generation, and they need to recognize the divine nature and power and the wisdom of this remarkable Quran. That's the first passage in sum. The second passage of the surah, the second section of the surah, is a long story of a unique long story, again, not told anywhere else in the Quran, of a nation that didn't just receive one, but three messengers. فَعَزَّزْنَا بِثَالِثٍ فَقَالُوا إِنَّا إِلَيْكُمْ مُرْسَلُونَ. Allah enforced them with three messengers that would preach to them, and they still wouldn't listen, and they would still ridicule and mock, to the point where actually another came from out of nowhere, from the far end of another town. He came running and spoke to them and said, you need to follow the messengers. You know, so and what's amazing about this story, so many unique elements. You typically don't get three messengers in one town. That's the first thing. The second thing is, those three messengers spoke briefly in the Quran, and their companion, you can say, the believer, who was now a faithful member of the believing community, a sahabi, if you will, a companion, he spoke more in the Quran. Allah quoted him more than all three messengers put together, which is pretty amazing. You would think that the messengers are there, he shouldn't be talking. He should just listen to them, or people just tell them, just listen to them. I don't have any place to speak. But it's as though he recognizes that the prophets have their job to do, the messengers have their job to do, I have my job to do. I'm obligated to speak the truth as well. And he doesn't absolve himself from that responsibility by just saying, well, the messengers are here, they're going to do their job. And that's something Allah highlights in this remarkable story, a profound lesson from history. And that's really how I like to title this second section, is a lesson from history. The third section is actually something, a signature of different places in the Quran, where Allah asks people to, okay, fine, you're not going to think about revelation, and you're not going to learn from history, at least look around you. Look around you. Ponder over the world that's been created around you. Have you ever thought about the earth that's dead, that's been brought back to life? Have you pondered over ships that sail in the sea? Have you pondered over the sky? These kinds of things. This is what Allah is going to highlight. And have you pondered over your children who make journeys for prosperity? You know, أَنَّا حَمَلْنَا ذُرِّيَّتَهُمْ فِي الْفُلْكِ الْمَشْحُونَ. They board their children up onto boarded ships. Like the image even of today of somebody putting their children on a flight to go so they can get a college education, or because they got a new job and things like that, right? So this idea of people traveling for prosperity purposes. Have you reflected even on this? How I allow all of this to happen, and how I give you the grace to be able to live good lives and flourish in this world. That's this third passage. So if I take you back again, it was the timeless wisdom of the Quran was one, lessons from history was two, and then the third was look around you and the world around you. That's number three. Passage number four contrasts with passage number three. It's a brief passage, just three ayat, where basically Allah says, there are some people who just refuse to see. No matter what you show them, they don't want to hear it. They're just blind to the truth. So these are people that refuse to ponder what is in front of them and what they have behind them, which is an interesting phrase, you know. اتقوا ما بين أيديكم وما خلفكم لعلكم ترحمون. Be cautious of what is right in front of you and what is behind you, so that you may be shown mercy, is a very succinct way of saying, why don't you look at what is right in front of you, which is things to reflect on as you visibly see them, and what is behind you is history, which was the previous passage before then. Because so far the Quran has talked about itself, it's talked about history and the world around us, and now it says there are some people who refuse to look at the world in front of them and refuse to look back at history as well. And they just remain stubborn no matter what you say, they don't want to change their behavior. This would be our fourth passage, the stubborn and the blind. Right? From here, you go to the consequences of being stubborn and blind. Allah will talk in the fifth passage about the day of judgment, resurrection, questioning, even people being thrown into the hellfire, and this horrible scene of judgment day and resurrection, where very little attention is given to those that are saved, and the majority of the time Allah highlights those that have not been saved and why they weren't saved. So the scary parts of hellfire and the scary parts of resurrection are given more emphasis in Surah Yasin than actually those that have been saved. It's interesting that in that passage, that which is the fifth passage of the surah, it's the middle ayah of the surah that's about the people of Jannah, and everything around it is the people of hellfire, remarkably. So that's your fifth passage. And finally, the last passage, the sixth passage of the surah, is actually about the Quran again, where it started. Like the first one was about the Quran, the last one's about the Quran. But this time Allah says it's not just poetry. First he said it's full of wisdom. And now he says, وَمَا عَلَّمْنَاهُ شِعْرًا. We didn't teach him poetry. وَمَا يَنْبَغِي لَهُ. It doesn't fit him either. It's not something that's befitting of the Prophet ﷺ, that he would just make poetry or entertain people. This revelation's not there to entertain you. And in contrast to the first one, in the first one Allah says the Quran's purpose is to guide heedless people that were just completely unaware. In this, he highlights there are people who Allah created from just a drop of fluid, and he created them out of nothing, and they act like they can argue with Allah. They're arrogant before the Quran. So there are two different bad attitudes towards the Quran: ignorance and heedlessness, which is in the beginning, and arrogance and pompous attitudes towards the Quran by the end. But both of those passages reflect the Quran. Now, what I want to share with you, just as an overview, there are six passages. I'll give them quick titles again so you can keep a mental map, right? So the first one was about the Quran and the heedless. And then Allah talked about lessons from history. Then He talked about the creation all around us. Then He talked about the blind. That was our fourth passage. The blind who refused to see creation around them, refused to think about the past. Then He talked about the day of judgment and what's going to happen to the criminals, and also what's going to happen to those who actually did take heed, who weren't blind. And finally, He'll talk about the Quran and how the arrogant don't respond to it the way that they should. This is a pretty amazing organization, because if you think of it, it begins with the timeless word of Allah and it ends with the timeless word of Allah. So the first and the last passage have something in common. They both are about the Quran. They're both about the timeless nature of the Quran, and they both highlight the attitudes that one should not have towards the Quran. If you look at what's left in the middle, four passages in the middle, they're actually in a chronological sequence. In other words, you've got history, then you've got look at the world around you as it is in the present, and those who don't look at the world around them as it is in the present, and then you've got the day of judgment, which is the future. So in a sense, in the middle, you've got the past, the present, and the future. This is pretty amazing. And then if you look at it yet another way, the first and the sixth passage are both about the Quran. The second passage is about the past, and the second last passage is about the future, contrasting one another. And the two middle passages are look around you, why are you so blind? They contrast each other too. So it actually forms this complete thematic symmetry in the surah. Inshallah, if those of you who get a chance to view the more detailed lectures on Surah Yasin, I've actually illustrated how not only is the surah thematically so perfectly organized and structurally like symmetrical, every single one of its passages is a symmetry by itself. Every single one of them has its own unique form of symmetry. Just to give you a small taste of that, just how one passage begins and ends, you've got the Quran in the first passage. That's the first thing Allah talks about, is the Quran. And by the end, He says, وَكُلَّ شَيْءٍ أَحْصَيْنَاهُ فِي إِمَامٍ مُبِينٍ. We recorded everything in a document. So He began with the divine document and He ended with the divine document. At the end, He said, we didn't teach Him poetry. That was the first thing He said about the last passage on the Quran. We didn't teach Him poetry. And the last ayah, إِنَّمَا أَمْرُهُ إِذَا أَرَادَ شَيْئًا أَنْ يَقُولَ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. He says, Allah, when He wants to do something, He says, be, and it becomes. So it began with the word of Allah, that isn't poetry, and it ends with the word of Allah, كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. There are parallels like that throughout the entire surah. So not only are the six themselves forming a symmetry, each one of them within themselves forms a perfect symmetry. It's absolutely mind-blowing how remarkable this surah is and how beautifully it deals with its subject matter. I want to leave you with one unique insight from this surah that just mesmerizes me. It really mesmerizes me. And it's something fascinating about the language of the Quran. The word yambaghi occurs twice in this surah. The word yambaghi means something to be appropriate, something to, you know, be befitting of someone. Okay, that's the idea of the word yambaghi. And it occurs in two almost completely unrelated contexts. And this is the idea of anchors in the Quran. Allah will use the same word for what seems completely unrelated, but it is in fact related. So I'll show you where it's used. It's absolutely mind-blowing. He says first about the sun and the moon. لَشَّمْسُ يَنْبَغِي لَهَا أَن تُدْرِكَ الْقَمَرُ وَلَا اللَّيْلُ سَابِقُ النَّهَارُ. It's not becoming of the sun to reach the moon, you know, to get ahead of the moon. So they have their own orbits. وَكُلٌّ فِي فَلَكٍ يَسْبَحُونَ. They're all moving in their own orbits. The sun and the moon should not be taking each other's plates or not running into each other or catching one another. It's not becoming of them. They've got their positions, they've got their roles to play. This is the first time yambaghi was used. All the way at the end of the surah, Allah says, وَمَا عَلَّمْنَاهُ الشِّعْرَ وَمَا يَنْبَغِي لَهُ. It's not, we didn't teach him poetry, it doesn't fit him either. It doesn't fit the Prophet either. So the word yambaghi was used once for the sun and once for the Prophet, which is pretty cool, because elsewhere in the Quran, Allah describes the Prophet, if you want to think about how the Prophet is, He describes him like the sun. Why? You know, وَدَاعِيًا إِلَى اللَّهِ بِإِذْنِهِ وَسِرَاجًا مُنِيرًا. You're a caller to Allah by His leave, and you are a brilliant lamp, a brilliant sun. Now the thing is, if the Prophet is the sun, if the Prophet is being compared to the sun, then the sun shines its light on the moon. And the moon only gets its light because of the sun. right? It's dependent on the sun. And the sun doesn't have phases. It's always brilliant and shining, but the moon has phases. It fluctuates. Sometimes it's a brilliant full moon. Sometimes it's weak. Sometimes, حَتَّى عَادَ كَالْعُرْجُونِ الْقَدِيمِ, the surah will say, until it becomes like a, you know, little a leaf of a palm tree. It'll become an old dried up leaf of a palm tree. So very, very skinny. That's what it'll become. You know what that means? That the sun is a representation, a creative representation of the Prophet's role, constantly shining light. And we, the Ummah, the believers of the Prophet ﷺ, are actually like the moon who go through phases, and any good that we have is actually a reflection of the good that he gave us, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Now, why is that important? You remember the story that I was telling you in this surah, in the second passage, where three messengers came, and there's a fourth, a believer who came, and Allah highlighted the believer more than even the three messengers. It's amazing. It's as though he understands, I have my job to play, and the existence of the prophets does not absolve me of my responsibility, just like the sun has its own orbit, and the moon has its own orbit, and they all have their jobs to do. لَالشَّمْسُ يَنْبَغِي لَهَا أَن تُدْرِكَ الْقَمَرَ وَلَلَّيْلُ سَابِقُ النَّهَارِ وَكُلٌّ فِي فَلَكٍ يَسْبَحُونَ. Actually, the heavenly bodies Allah created, all of them have a role to play, just like messengers have their own role to play, and the members of their nations, the members of the Ummah of the Prophet ﷺ, have their own role to play, and one does not absolve the other. SubhanAllah. Just by the crafty use of words in the Quran, we get such profound, profound insight.